Hi, my name is Samantha Namachek Belding, and I live in Grand Rapids, Michigan. While I was born here, my story took me out to Colorado in 2012, where I went to graduate school in Denver. We experienced some of the arm's length impacts of things like forest fires and flooding, but it was minimal, to say the least. In 2015, I moved down to southern Colorado to a town called Manitou Springs. And we bought our home there in 2016. I love the community. I love the people. And my now husband and I, we bought our home there and we made our home there. But that community was peppered with trauma and loss resulting from three fairly recent environmental impacts, those being two larger scale fires and one flood resulting after one of those fires. And when we bought our home, hindsight being 2020, it was out of the floodplain, we were good. However, we never even thought about forest fires. And when we moved in, it was something we occasionally would have to be wary of, you know, forest fire smoke. For me, I consider forest fire smoke to be much more acrid, not at all like the smell I enjoy in a fire pit. The smoke from a fire pit is it burns my eyes, it burns my nose. And when I would wake up in the mornings, I would smell that. And that would give me horrible anxiety because you don't know, can I go to work today? Do I have to wait here? Where's the fire coming from? Have they pinpointed the fire yet? We lived on the boundary of Forest Service. And Forest Service, just like everyone in the United States, since the turn into the 1900s, they went through a period of fire suppression. Conservation, fire suppression. That meant that the wood they were trying to grow would stay longer in theory, but in reality, they created a powder keg. And that's what a lot of American forest fires, that's why a lot of them get so bad so quickly, is there was a period of fire suppression, not controlled burning. So now, when I smell it, back then, it created an extreme anxiety in me. I could smell it and I would know that that is a forest fire. The question is not if, it's when it's going to happen to you. And it was always the question of where is it coming from? Is it near or is it really far away? It wasn't until the summer of 2020 when those impacts hit me and my husband so hard. Obviously it was during COVID, and there were two periods of a week at a time where we were not able to leave our home other than to go to work, grocery shopping. Sadly, the air quality was so bad we couldn't see our neighbors. The color of the smoke was something eerie. It was red, orange, gray. It changed based upon wind direction, and we lived in a small valley in town, so how it got funneled up and down, it depended on the day. But we, like a lot of people in older homes, didn't necessarily, especially out west, we didn't have HVAC systems, so we'd have to shut our windows, and it was in the middle of the summer, so it was 90 degrees outside. We had to keep our windows shut. We couldn't open them at night. I really suffered the effects. I was pregnant at the time. I was suffering the effects from the smoke. There's nothing we could do about it. We tried to get air filters, air filtration devices in town. It was all sold out. Everyone else needed the same thing. Amazon, it was back ordered for weeks because people in Colorado everywhere were experiencing these effects. So we just kind of had to wade through that situation, and we got through it. But it changed the way I look at forest fires, because forest fires, not only do they burn, but they inherently change the quality, like the way you live your life, because air is so important. Until you have so poor quality to breathe, you don't realize how important it is. And in 2020, a family situation brought us back to where we grew up here in Michigan, which is touted as a climate haven. But maybe I'm more sensitive than others, but the air quality here is not nearly the way it was when I was growing up. I think it was either this summer or last summer where we had an air quality index of it hit 200. That is horrific. That is just as bad as it was in those bad situations out west. So feeling out of control, not knowing how I can help my kids, even if I can't do anything in the moment, there's things that I can do to become more resilient. And that for me is knowledge. The more knowledge I have, the more resilient I can be and my family can be by association. So I've joined, I get hope and for the future, and I know I'm becoming more resilient by joining volunteer organizations, Climate Citizens League, which is an international organization that has a local chapter. I am a urban gardener. I love gardening. We grow our own food. And I've actually signed up for emergency management training through my local municipality. So I can help my community and I can know how to handle emergency situations, the basics. Everything is different in the moment. But that's my climate story.